Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents I Like You Just Fine When You're Not Around by Ann Garvin. Narrated by Teri Schnaubelt. Chapter 1. Horn Broken, Look for Finger. Tig Monahan tried to imagine what it would be like to lose her mind. Was it like a quick, fully aware, terror-filled slip on an icy sidewalk? Or slower, where a tiny skidding sensation goes unnoticed until suddenly you realize all four limbs are in the air and your face is in a ditch? With her mother, Hallie, it was hard to tell what she'd been aware of, or how the knotted neurons in her brain foretold her foggy future. Either way, her mother's mind was not her own. Her secrets were locked inside, and Tig was left to ponder the icy aftermath. It was almost 6 p.m., and Hallie's nightly agitation was right on time. Actually, a half hour ahead of schedule, due to the recent relocation from Tig's home to Hope House.
"Where is he?"
her mother said, her voice flapping like a bird startled from its roost.
"Is your father here?"
Hallie worked the worn platinum wedding band, loose beneath her knuckle, around and around.
"He said I should wait."
She shoved the bedside stand out of the way and stood, the evening version of her dementia giving her a kind of agility that her laid-back daytime confusion seemed to eschew. "It's okay, Mom. I'm here. I've got you." Her mother emptied her purse onto the bed.
"Wendy, get your father."
"It's Tig, Mom." Tig, the forgotten daughter and sister to Wendy the absent Monahan, said, "What are you looking for?" Hallie stopped in her frantic search through her purse and snapped,
"What do you think I'm searching for? It's always right here in this pocket."
Her piercing blue eyes were clearly seeing one daughter where the other one stood, reminding Tig of how sure her mother had always been. Sure and blunt and lovely. Her signature soft, sun-blonde hair now frayed and wild, white, her once full lips turned inward with the sourness of age.
"N'est-ce pas?"
her mother said, changing from agitation to despondency, to French, a language she loved and remembered better than her family. She snatched Tig's hand in her pale fist. Tig worked to keep her own anxiety locked inside, knowing that when she cried, it only upset her mother.
"We can't all cry,"
her mother used to say when Tig and Wendy were girls.
"Someone has to man the battle stations."
Tig struggled against her grief, her lips twitching in effort. A nurse swept into the room, responding to the call bell Tig had silently rung for assistance. Over her mother's head, Tig said,
"I thought maybe tonight she wouldn't need a sedative. I thought if I spent the whole day with her, it might help."
The nurse drew a line with her lips and looked sympathetically at Tig, as if to say, "Here's another one who just doesn't get it yet. Another relative really low on the learning curve."
"Alzheimer's softens for no man, no how, no way. It's been 1 week. She was at your home for much longer than that. She needs time to acclimate."
To Tig's mother, she said,
"Hallie, let's get you settled for the night."
Hallie Monahan ignored the nurse and began tearing at her sheets. Tig said,
"My mom ran her own business. She was a vet and a single parent. You have no idea how much she would hate being seen like this. Hate being here."
The nurse spoke to Hallie in a tone that made Tig want to curl up on the wrinkled bedding for a nap.
"Hallie, love, I have your medication here. Try some orange juice. Here you go."
Inexplicably, Hallie turned, flipped the small pill into her mouth, and slammed back her orange juice like a drunk in a biker bar. She returned to her sheets and buried her arm up to her elbow in the pillowcases and searched.
"If I could tell you," her mother said.
Behind her, Tig said,
"Mom, let's sit down."
When her mother didn't budge, Tig said to the nurse, "She had an almost photographic memory. Photographic." The emphatic way she said photographic got her mother's attention, and for just a moment she gazed at Tig with what almost seemed like clarity. But just as quickly, her mother's face fell, and she returned to yanking at her ring.
"I shouldn't have moved her out of my house." Her mother upended her now empty purse for the 10th time, muttering, "It's here. It's always here." "You did the right thing. Just let this medicine take effect. You should go home and get some rest. Don't you work in the morning?" The nurse gently massaged her mother's back. Tig pulled the bedsheets tight, arranged the waterproof pad, and retrieved a rolled-up nylon from the floor. "Yes, but I'll just stay until she falls asleep." Tig placed her arm around her suddenly still mother. "I've got you, Mom," she said, and guided her to the edge of the bed. Hallie sighed and said, "I just can't keep it secret anymore." "What, Mom? What secret? What are you looking for?" Her mother sighed and said, "You're nice," as if Tig were a sweet stranger who just didn't understand, and her mother couldn't be bothered to explain. A dull ache in Tig's neck woke her from a surprisingly sound sleep. She'd fallen asleep holding her mother's hand at an angle that made her arm tingle. Not wanting to let her mother go, she switched hands with her and tried to wriggle blood flow back into her cold fingers. As if disgusted by Tig's pathetic display of affection, Hallie snorted in her sleep and pulled her hand free. Seeing her mother asleep in a standard hospital bed seemed to lift the curtain of denial from Tig's vision. Her mother had always had colorful red lips, blue eyes, and yellow hair. But here in this parched place, she was monochromatic, an even palette of sand after an era of drought. Tig resisted putting a dab of lip balm onto her mother's pale lips. Her mother hated to be fussed with. When Tig had complained as a teen about getting ready for prom, saying that all her friends had appointments for updos, her mother had said, "What a colossal waste of time and money. I hope you know by now that beauty is about a little lip gloss and joie de vivre." Tig believed that lesson alone had probably paid for her graduate school, since she'd avoided mani-pedis, complicated hair dyes, and spa visits. It was also a lesson in self-esteem, that self-worth cannot be bought and applied from a bottle. The unfairness that this woman from Tig's memory, so ripe with life and possibility, could have been transformed into this husk of a woman, made Tig feel dry by proxy. A nurse she didn't recognize pushed a wheeled medicine cart past her mother's room and glanced inside without expression. Tig stood, stretched her back, and rocked her head side to side. Her phone lay where she'd left it on top of a comforter she'd brought from home. She'd planned to call Pete, her boyfriend, but had fallen asleep instead. Tig hit the power button. The phone lit up and displayed the time, 6:30. As she leisurely compared it to the wall clock with the huge numbers, Tig whispered, 6:30? Oh my God. She grabbed her bag and race-walked out the door and down the hall. Before life had become impossible, she had begun her therapy hours at 7 a.m. so that people could get a little therapy high five and then go to their day jobs. Every night that she spent with her mother, 7 a.m. came sooner and sooner, and the past week it had become a habit to skid into her office while calling her dog sitter and trying to brush her hair out with dry shampoo. After a quick gargle in the clinic's bathroom, Tig drove to her office and sat behind her desk. She took a sip of coffee from the cup with, "Go on, I'm listening," printed on the side. Because that's what she did as a relationship therapist. She listened. After a busy morning of one-on-one visits, Tig was determined to finish her last day of work, shower, walk Thatcher, and take a nap before heading back to her mother's room. She would wrangle her silent and invisible sister home, empty her trash, and work to get her boyfriend to understand she needed more time before following him to Hawaii for his sabbatical. Today, the only thing that sat between Tig and the rest of her life was the fighting Harmeyers. Jean and Newman Harmeyer, the counseling world's most insufferable couple. Not the couple, really. It was the husband who was insufferable, unbearable, repugnant.
"She knew exactly who I was when she married me."
Newman Harmeyer cast scathing looks at Tig and his wife Jean, the soft flesh of his jaw jiggling. Tig assessed the couple seated across from each other in her office, more sparring partners than teammates. She opened her mouth to speak, but Newman interrupted her.
She's the one who's changed, nagging me about work all the time. So what if I go golfing and buy a few rounds afterward? I always come home.
Eventually, said Jean, and she lifted her chin.
It's not like I'm fooling around.
You could be. I'd never know. I don't know what you're doing most of the time. We never make love. To Tig, she said, I tried to get him in for a checkup.
I'm tired, Jean. I don't need to go to the doctor. I don't need therapy. I just need a wife who gets it.
Oh, I get it all right. Tig scrubbed her eyes under her glasses and shot a quick look at the clock on the table between her and the angry couple on the couch across from her. 10 more minutes, and she could say goodbye to Newman Harmeyer.
Did you just check the time?
Newman Harmeyer fairly spit the words at Tig. Startled, Tig rolled her chair back a guilty inch.
What? He demanded. Are we not interesting enough for you? Is that it? For Christ's sake, Jean, why are you wasting my time?
Tig blinked hard, but as irritated as she was, she glanced at Jean Harmeyer's tasteful, pained expression and opened her mouth to apologize. Newman took advantage of Tig's hesitation and launched into his next tirade.
You'd rather go home, would you? Get on with your day?
With a disgusted shake of his head, he said,
Ridiculous.
The sneer in his voice sliced through Tig's veneer, rattling the thinnest tolerance that caged her fury. She heard her mother's voice from her youth. Girls, I am on my last nerve. Tig slid her gaze away from Jean Harmeyer's stiff face, turned her attention to Newman Harmeyer, then narrowed her eyes. I apologize to both of you for my inattention. I have had a difficult week. My mother has been very ill. That said, I think we should call it quits before either of us says something we might regret, she said in her most precise psychologist distinction. Newman Harmeyer had the bearing of the playground bully, cocky with a history of successful intimidation in his portfolio.
I'm paying you to listen to me, not whine about your mother. You got something to say to me? Because now's the time. We won't be back to this dump.
He gestured dismissively around her small windowed office, with the overly sympathetic spider plant and silent, easy-to-spill-your-guts-on couch. In that moment, Tig thought about her lovely, kind mother who was now anxious and confused in a nursing home, while this man was free to berate and abuse as he saw fit. As if from above, Tig saw herself, sitting in her own office, being treated like a naughty child by this vile man. In that second, a second she would regret later, she felt the sleep deprivation clear and the blanket of fatigue that shrouded her courage lift. She felt sure the universe was giving her permission to take a good, healthy swing. Tig pivoted in her padded office chair to squarely face Newman Harmeyer. She saw that he had the childlike glee of a boxer, briefly free of the ropes, just before the knockout punch. Seriously, Mr. Harmeyer, your problems couldn't keep an insomniac awake. She paused and watched as the dimmer switch behind his eyes ratcheted up a few degrees. I didn't need the last 6 months to get the picture. I get it. Your wife gets it. Every cliched, old, desperate man in the universe gets it. Your wife is more competent than you, more attractive than you, and makes more money than you, so you're having a midlife tantrum, but you won't admit that. Instead, you take it out on her by drinking, detaching from the family, and denigrating your marriage. You are doing everything but actually having an affair, which would allow Jean to divorce you without guilt. With a shaky hand, Tig stood and smoothed her black trousers, tucked the yellow legal pad under her arm, and put herself between her desk and the stunned couple. Shut up, Tig, shut up, she thought, but she couldn't stop. It was as if she was defending her mother, her client, and herself when she added, And you're a prick. Tig met Newman Harmeyer's shocked look without flinching, despite being aware of the heat creeping into her cheeks. Newman said,
What?
And hauled himself to his full height. Tig squared her shoulders. Here's one piece of advice for free. Why don't you join the Peace Corps and spend some time with people who have real problems? While you're at it, get down on your knees and thank the Lord that this amazing woman over here hasn't divorced your sloppy reptilian self. Newman Harmeyer clenched his right fist and took a step closer. Tig? She noticed the vein at his temple and reflexively took a step back, glanced at her desk telephone, and gauged the distance. Surprising Tig, he turned on his heel, took the two steps to the office door, wrenched it open, and let it swing wide and crash against the wall.
Come on, Jean.
As if she were slowly waking up, Jean Harmeyer stood and followed her husband, nearly colliding with him as he stopped to say with a gritty grin,
You just lost your job, missy.
With his eyes on Tig, he walked through the door, catching his cell phone secured on his hip, and it bounced back into the room. The couple stopped and stared at the disobedient device, seeming to balance its electronic value in their lives against the value of the perfect, righteously indignant exit. It was a neck-and-neck competition. Finally, with a slight tilt to her hips, Jean Harmeyer disappeared through the doorway while her husband bent and reached for his phone. After missing it with the first pass, he tucked his tie beneath his belly and made another swipe. Phone in hand, he gestured with significant force and spittle, saying,
You're going to need a lawyer.
Tig grasped her desk and dropped her head. The abrupt quiet in the room was interrupted by the incessant beep of a delivery truck backing up outside the coffee shop next door. Tig pulled her dark hair up and away from her face and neck and held it briefly before letting it swing down and brush her cheeks. Tig read the simple reminder taped to her desk. 1. You count 2. She peeled the note from her desk, carefully placed it in her large leather bag, and watched her shaking hand as she pushed the 0 button on the phone to connect to the receptionist.
Macy? Have the Harmeyers left?
Macy's pixie voice popped through the speaker.
Oh, I heard them. He bitched all the way out the door. I don't know what you said, but he is pissed.
Macy extended the word pissed for emphasis. Tig rested her head in her hand. I doubt they'll need a referral to another therapist. They won't be back.
Don't count Mrs. Harmeyer out. She had a killer look on her face and she rescheduled for herself.
She did? Wow, good. Maybe she'll stand up to him after all.
Tig paused and then said,
Give me a few minutes to get myself together, and then can you dial the business office at my mother's nursing home?
Sure, Dr. Monahan. Take as long as you need.
By the way, where can I get that bumper sticker your brother has?
Mean people suck?
No, the other one. Horn broken, look for finger. I think that might be my new motto.
Chapter 2. Lipstick and Cigarettes. With an unsteady hand, Tig pulled her smartphone from her purse, obsessively checking her messages. Nothing. If only Wendy would call. If her older sister would come help with their mother, Tig could go with Pete on his sabbatical, guilt-free. Tig whispered,
Frickin' Wendy.
Wendy defied birth order personality predictors of the firstborn child. She was supposed to be what Tig was, dependable, conscientious, cautious, the leader of the pack. Instead, Wendy acted like the littlest chimp, equally likely to swing from a chandelier, buy a convertible, or finagle a free cruise from a handsome millionaire. She was not the girl to count on when papers needed sorting, furniture had to be moved from a childhood home, or mothers relocated. Somehow, Tig managed to get a dose of both first and second child. She was structured and responsible, a caretaker, but also a people pleaser, while Wendy swanned around, all show-off energy and big ideas. Tig needed some of that indomitable energy now, because as it stood, Tig couldn't even go to work without guilt and then losing her shit. The desk phone rang and Tig picked it up. Macy's voice said,
I have Hope's house business office on the line.
Tig cleared her throat, calling forth her professional, no-nonsense voice.
This is Tig Monahan. I'm trying to understand why I have not yet received any bills for my mother, Hallie Monahan.
Yes, Dr. Monahan, as you know, we cannot release information about your mother's trust and the specifics of her care here unless I have permission from your mother.
My mother is incapable of that. I'm her daughter and her power of attorney. I need to know the financial details in case I'm required to make decisions in the future.
Unruffled, the woman on the phone said, I assure you that our bills are taken care of and will be in the future as well. Rest easy.
Forgive me if your assurance isn't enough for me, she checked herself and said. I'm sorry, I'm just tired.
The line was quiet and Tig waited for a softening. When none came, she said,
I'll stop in. Thank you.
Tig hung up, pulled a cardboard box from beneath her desk, and rearranged the diploma and cactus inside to make room for her empty coffee cup, a glass jar of almonds, an O. Henry bar, and a stick of melon-flavored lip balm. She had agreed to go with Pete. She had committed to accompanying him on his sabbatical, and at least packing up her office was a step closer to honoring that wobbly commitment. She laid the photograph of Pete on top of a stack of Hawaii brochures. Pete gazed up at her with his perfect teeth displayed in his It Never Rains in California grin. Tig closed her eyes and ran her thumb across Pete's smile. Macy poked her head into Tig's office.
Mrs. Biddle is here?
No way. I thought we had closure last week.
You did. She just showed up wearing that t-shirt that says my other shirt is in the laundry. Says she just needs a few minutes. I could suggest she take those minutes to actually do the laundry.
Tig considered this and said, Maybe if I don't berate Mrs. Biddle, I won't feel so terrible about everything else in my life. Macy started to speak, but Tig said, Send her in. I need to redeem myself. Maybe when the Harmeyer's lawyers come and try to take my license away, she'll speak up for me. 40 minutes into the appointment with Mrs. Biddle, Tig realized that, instead of making her feel better, Mrs. Biddle was making her feel anxious and, frankly, hopeless. Mrs. Biddle undid the blue plastic child's barrette that held her dyed jet-black hair in place on the left side of her head. She had an identical yellow barrette holding her hair behind her right ear. She pulled her hair tight and reclipped it, forcing her bangs to poof forward and create a kingfisher-like headpiece. There was no way this woman was going to save Tig today, or when the lawyers came. Mrs. Biddle clasped her hands.
I can't believe she's gone.
She was only 65, but with the facial puckering of a career smoker, Mrs. Biddle looked 75. There was no doubt in Tig's mind that the strongest muscles in Mrs. Biddle's body were around her lips. The rest of her muscle tone had gone out of her like the flame of a candle, the conquering breath being the death of her daughter. Tig suspected the older woman lived on lipstick and cigarettes. She touched Mrs. Biddle's arm.
Go home tonight and have a good meal, she urged. Remember how important creating unusual meals was to Francine? She'd want you to thaw out one of those dinners she left behind for you. Maybe call a friend over.
Mrs. Biddle looked into Tig's eyes.
Would that help you if you'd killed your only child?
Tig shook her head.
You didn't kill Francine. People get cancer for lots of reasons. She hadn't been around your smoking for years and years. I thought we'd moved beyond that kind of thinking.
Tig examined the lines surrounding Mrs. Biddle's tired eyes.
I'm so sorry, but we're out of time for today. I want you to think about the meal you will choose to eat in honor of your daughter tonight. Call a friend and consider bringing home that puggle at the Humane Society you talked about.
Mrs. Biddle took a breath and moved through the office door. With surprising speed and strength, she reached back and briefly gripped Tig's hand, looked her in the eye, and said,
Why are you leaving? You know you don't want to.
Tig opened her mouth to protest, but Mrs. Biddle released her hand and stepped away before Tig could utter a word. With her coat slung over her arm and her bag dangling from one shoulder, Tig walked to the front desk where Macy sat, fringed black bangs in her eyes, clicking through computer screens.
Well, I did it. I finished my last day, ruined my career, and made myself miserable. You'll forget all this in Hawaii, Dr. M.
I'm not sure I'm going right away, Tig said. I think I'm going to tie some things up at home first, get my mom settled. Macy tugged the gauge in her earlobe.
Oh, is that okay?
How long before the Harmeyers call Julie and ask her to fire me?
He already called.
It's good it's my last day. Tig stared at the floor.
How's your mom?
Not so good. That's why this decision to wait to go to Hawaii feels right.
You know, aside from calling Newman Harmeyer a prick, I don't feel too terrible. I really should feel worse.
Oh yeah, calling someone a prick is totally therapeutic.
Macy fiddled with her gauge again.
There's research.
Chapter 3. Runners Run.
As Tig Monahan turned onto the highway, a cavalry of sunshine raced through the windshield, as if it might save the day from the disaster to come. She switched on the radio, opened the sunroof, and accelerated. Between the music, the breeze, and the feelings of guilty freedom swirling around her, Tig, fixer of the troubled mind, daughter of the year, forgot for just a moment the cost of liberty, the psychological fee associated with breaking all promises and putting your confused mother into memory care when it's the last thing you wanted to do. With practiced automation, she signaled and turned onto her street. The speed radar trailer at the entry of her neighborhood blinked the too fast warning in red and blue. Tig braked hard and watched her purse tumble upside down onto the floor. If she were superstitious, she might have crossed herself and said a quick prayer. Instead, Tig tried to retrieve her phone and wallet while swerving at the last minute and bumping into her driveway. She shoved the door of her Subaru open and rushed to her front stoop. The purse slid off her shoulder as she pulled the screen open, sending her keys clattering to her feet. She said to no one, "Today, I don't even effing care." Tig dumped her bag onto the hardwood floor. Her black labradoodle, Margaret Thatcher, looked up from the black leather couch and banged a friendly Morse code with her tail. With great dignity, the curly-haired dog stood, dropped her front paws to the floor, and executed a flawless downward dog. "Hi, girl. Did you have a nice day with Stacy?" Stacy was Tig's next-door neighbor, a single 30-something graphic designer who worked from home. She was Tig's unofficial dog sitter and was always available to rescue Thatcher from whatever scheduling conflicts Tig got herself into. She scratched Thatcher's back and said, "I made a big decision today. Is Pete here? Where is Pete?" Tig straightened and quickly peeled a note off the front door. "This is home." She folded it carefully, the tape crinkled and stuck together in her hand, while she snatched another note off the hall closet. "Coats and shoes." "Pete?" In the kitchen, yellow post-its fluttered like leaves on the light oak cupboards and stainless appliances, remnants of her mother's confusion and evidence of Tig's exhausting life as a caregiver. One by one, she ripped each note free from its place. "Hot." "Forks." "Cups." "Turn off." "Towels." "Dishwasher." "Stove." "Tig's cell phone." "Help, 911. With one hand clutching imperatives, she yanked the empty suitcase from her bed onto the floor and kicked it under the bed. At the sound of the front door opening, she shoved the post-it notes into the garbage next to her bed and covered them with tissues. As Tig rounded the corner, Pete strode into the living room, wiping his face and smearing his sweaty palms across his Runner's Run t-shirt. The Runner's Run was a 24-hour running match where sleep was profane and mileage was the holy grail. The goal? To rack up as many miles as possible in a 24-hour period by both pacing and killing yourself. It was neither fun nor just a run, in Tig's opinion. Her only role in her boyfriend's athletic endeavors was to hold the Gatorade and the Go Pete sign.
"You're home," he said.
The late afternoon sun sat loyally on his shoulders, and the scent of the final moments of a successful summer day wafted into the room. Margaret Thatcher licked the salt from Pete's fingers, bumping her tail against the wall. Tig pulled another post-it from the thermostat that read, "Don't touch," and stuck it into her back pocket. Pete didn't seem to notice. Tig followed his eyes to the spare room off the living room, where several pieces of luggage-sized duffel bags sat clustered in the doorway.
"I thought you'd be later," he said. "You know, tying up stuff at the office."
Tig stepped closer to him. I know you think I haven't been getting ready for the trip, but I have. I've been cleaning out files all month, so I came home to talk about the trip. She stretched to kiss him, but he stepped back, saying,
I'm sweaty.
Tig glanced at his packed bags and said, Looks like you've made a lot of progress today. When he didn't respond, she said, Since I'm home early, let's go get something to eat and celebrate. Maybe we could stop in to see my mom later. He started, then said,
I think we should talk about something.
Yes, good. I want to talk about something, too. Pete touched the scar behind his ear, an early sign of nerves to those who knew him, a tiny poker tell to loved ones wanting a read. Tig said, Should we talk at dinner? She noticed Pete's hesitation and said, Or here. Here's good. What's up? Is something wrong?
I don't think this is something to really worry about, but it's been on my mind lately. I think I should talk about it, in fairness.
Tig frowned and said, Okay, I feel like I should sit down. Should I sit down? Pete grabbed the bottom of his t-shirt, exposing his tight abdominal muscles, and wiped his face.
I don't know why this is, but I'm just not that excited about you lately.
He squeezed his eyes shut and tried again.
I mean, I'm not excited about anything right now. This sabbatical, going to Hawaii, that's why it's not about you.
A cold frost gripped Tig's neck and shoulders. You're not that excited about me?
That came out wrong. What I mean is, this whole trip, I don't know why I'm not more excited about going.
He wiped his face with his t-shirt again and added,
With you.
Pete paced away from her and turned.
This isn't coming out right at all. Something isn't right with me.
Something isn't right with you, Tig repeated.
I should be more excited.
I think you need to stop saying that. Her counselor self kicked in and she said, Are you saying that you don't know how you feel about this trip? Her non-counselor self said, Since when? Since yesterday? Since last week? Margaret Thatcher seemed to follow the conversation, and, as if taking sides, the dog walked over to Tig and leaned against her leg. Tig absently touched the top of her silky head, extracting a tiny measure of quiet comfort from the dog's solidarity. Pete stared at her. Then, with resolution, he grabbed a duffel.
I've just been thinking. Maybe I should go to Hawaii alone, at least at first.
What are you saying? Am I disinvited? Tig couldn't decide how she felt about this. The tables were turning in both the best and absolute worst ways. She'd come home to tell Pete to go, and she would follow. However, now that he was suggesting this very thing on his own, and with this new lack of excitement, Tig shivered.
No, not forever.
He pushed the screen open and swung the luggage out the door. It landed in a thud on the front stoop.
Though I'm not sure you ever really wanted to go.
Wait a minute. That's not what we're talking about. Tig watched Pete grab another duffel bag. She wrung her hands and looked around for support, a wall, a chair, something to stand on that wasn't sinking. You invited me. You said I could stay 6 months or the full year, so I said yes. I didn't ask to come with you.
I know, and I still want you to come. Maybe just not right away.
All of a sudden, Tig felt defensive and confused. What are you saying? I left my job. As if Tig had opened a door labeled the bright side, Pete moved to her.
This will give you the time you wanted to get your mom settled, pack up the house more, maybe find renters like you wanted. I'll get set up in Hawaii and then you can come.
You are doing this for me? She stalled. In that second, Tig recognized what she was doing. She was trying to help Pete get through the conversation and save face for herself. She was getting what she wanted, but in the midst of this, she found she only wanted it if he loved her. She needed to know, but was too afraid of the answer.
With her emotions zigzagging, she tried to recover a little self-esteem. Tig said, "You don't want me. That's what you're saying."
"No," he said. "You're taking this wrong."
"How should I take it? No woman ever wants to hear that the person she..." And she hesitated here, meaning to say loves, but instead said, "made plans with, is not that excited about them." Tig moved around the room as if tiny fires had broken out, overwhelming her with heat. "I don't want to hear that from my mailman, let alone my boyfriend," she muttered. She watched Pete toss the last bag out the front door and said,
"Could you just stop? Did I do something wrong?"
"That's just it. No, I didn't think it was fair to go to Hawaii without talking about this."
Pete moved and Tig put her hand up to stop him. He tried again.
"This will give you more time to get everything in order, like you wanted to before this sabbatical came up."
Tig opened her mouth to speak. She wanted to say, "But I want to say that." Instead, she clamped her mouth shut. Dignity is what she thought. Her mother used to say, "Be pleased, not eager." "It's true, Pete. At first, I couldn't imagine leaving my mom in the nursing home alone while I snorkeled with you. Then she hurt herself and I did the thing I don't ever do. I let go for a change." She thought of her stately and completely confused mother, sitting in her unfamiliar room at Hope House, and added with a spark of resentment,
"We talked about getting married. How dare you attach the word fairness to this?"
For the second time in 24 hours, she saw that she did not know what she wanted, and she could not shut her mouth. Pete's lined face lost its boyishness. The scar on the side of his head pulsed with the clench of his jaw.
"I knew you were going to say that."
"This is all so out of the blue. You made a decision before we'd discussed anything."
"I'm trying to discuss this right now, and I'm not leaving you."
Tig straightened her shoulders and said, "I don't know what you are doing here, Pete." She looked him directly in the eyes.
"Hawaii and us, that was your idea. It took me a while to get on board, but..."
She frowned.
"Call this what you want, but don't call it fair."
He opened his mouth to say more, looked down at his triathlon watch and then his shoes, and said,
"I just thought..."
She saw in that moment how uncomfortable he was, and in a flash she felt sorry for him. It was what made her an effective counselor, an oft-requested caregiver, this overriding feeling of empathy that flooded her emotions and sank her defenses. She thought maybe if she didn't make a fuss, if she did what she always tried to do with people, to be no trouble to anyone. She said,
"Okay, I have to do some thinking. You should go."
And then she did something else she wanted to slap herself for later. She hugged him and kissed his soft, salty lips, effectively and completely letting him off the hook. Tig stared at his back as he walked away, and as the screen door slammed shut, she rushed to it. With the last bit of courage her ego could manage, she said,
"Don't call me, don't."
She started to turn away and raised her voice.
"Period."
She knew in that instant that he wouldn't. She knew there would be no tearful "I'm sorry's" or long explaining conversations. That wasn't Pete. That wasn't either of them. Then her strength seemed to ebb away, and Tig felt herself dissolve like a sandcastle in a hard wind. She wiped her eyes with a brutal tenting of her thumb and forefinger. She sank to the couch and reached for her phone, but who could she call? Her mother, whose memory had been erased as effectively as chalk on the sidewalk after a summer shower? Her self-obsessed sister Wendy, who only answered her phone 1 in 10 times? There were other people, friends, but most of her friends had warned her about Pete, calling him the boy man of Madison, Wisconsin. Friends who, one by one, disappeared under the scheduling nightmare that exists when you move your mother into your house and become her caregiver, before you become a mother yourself. She took a tortured breath and rubbed her chest, remembering her mother's soft hands on her sternum after a bad dream, how her mother's touch used to calm her childish concerns. Sometimes Hallie was quiet during those times. Other times, she'd distract Tig by telling her about the animals in the clinic.
"The Great Dane walked right in like he owned the place," she might begin a story. "His name was Beauregard Halsey. He was a crabby old dog with a heart murmur. He'd get excited and pass out, which made him look like he had rollerblades on. He'd go over, and his legs would stick out like an old wooden stool."
Her stories could make Tig laugh, or could help her fall back asleep. The magic lay in her mother's talk about the continuation of life, the business-as-usual goings-on that confirmed the world had not ended. This was her mother in a nutshell. These memories did nothing for Tig now, other than make her feel a profound sense of loss. She put her head in her hand. Thatcher moved again to Tig's side.
"Come here, girl," Tig said, stroking the dog around the soft folds of her neck. "I don't know what just happened."
As the dog clambered up onto the couch beside her, Tig sighed and said,
"We got a runner, girl, and runners run. That's what they do."
Chapter 4, An Inconvenient Truth. Tig lay with Thatcher on the couch as the sunlight faded, her cell phone still in her hand. The sun moved, time passed, and Tig snuggled closer to her best friend as the temperature dipped in the room and the shadows circled. She heard the sound of someone approaching the front door, which she noticed only now was still open, and she and the dog scrambled to a sitting position.
"Pete?"
"Hey, Dr. M, it's me."
The high-pitched voice of her former assistant, Macy, warbled through the screen. She carried the cardboard box Tig had packed earlier.
"You were so ready to leave us behind and party on with your new life, you left this on the front desk. I thought I'd just drop it by."
Macy opened the door with her free hand and poked her head into the foyer. Tig braced herself against Margaret Thatcher and stood.
"You look kind of disorganized, Doc."
"I'm not going to Hawaii, and I think Pete left me."
"What?"
"He left. I'm not going."
Tig brushed her hands together.
"So there you have it."
She took the box from Macy and dropped it on a dying philodendron on the coffee table. Macy pulled the box off the struggling plant and followed Tig into the kitchen.
"What the heck happened?"
"I'm not sure, but whatever it was, it happened really fast."
Tig looked around at nothing.
"I'm giving myself permission to act very non-counselor-like for the next 24 hours. Right now, I'm going to send him a text."
Tig said text like she meant bomb.
"All right, your loss, bucko. I'll put an exclamation point on it."
Tig pressed the buttons on her phone, saying,
"Why does it keep changing bucko to cuckoo?
Wait, maybe I'll leave it cuckoo."
"That'll show him,"
Macy said. Tig glanced at Macy.
"What, not strong enough? How about, don't call me when you're lonely, pal? Can you italicize text?"
She dropped her hands and said,
"Wait, what if I want him to call me when he's lonely?"
Macy pulled a piece of lint off Tig's shoulder as Tig said,
"No, I don't. I know, I'm going to send him the very succinct and always appropriate, you suck. No exclamation point needed."
"Rule number one of texting, Dr. M, never text when you're drunk or angry."
Macy eased the phone from Tig's grasp, then guided her over to the kitchen table.
"Right. That's very wise, Macy. Okay, then."
"Dr. M, let's get you a glass of water, then you can fill me in."
Tig eased herself onto the solid wooden chair next to her beloved farm table. She and Pete had bought the table together at an estate sale. She closed her eyes, remembering. They'd driven back from the sale and were eating at No Hablo Inglés, their favorite Mexican restaurant, where red, green, and white crepe paper piñatas mocked their serious conversation. After the bike accident that had left a dramatic scar on his head, Pete also lost his sense of smell and could only taste hot, spicy foods. She said,
"You have to wash your running clothes more, honey. You smell terrible."
It's my go-green solution to global warming.
I think even Al Gore would agree that washing a t-shirt occasionally is not an excessive use of resources. The inconvenient truth here, sweetie, is that you stink like chicken soup and mildew. Why not stop buying new running shoes made by small children in Malaysia if you really want to help the universe?
You're such an eco-bully, Tig. Are you coming to Hawaii with me?
No hablo happy, she'd thought. The constant push, push, push that went with Pete's enthusiasm and decision-making made her feel anxious, not loved. She hadn't made her decision, and she didn't like being pressured. The slightly soapy rim of the amber-colored water glass, the nubby texture of the lightweight plastic against her fingers, felt stingy and cheap. It's not what I want or don't want, she'd said. I have responsibilities, Pete.
People do what they want to do. You and I both know that.
Pete's eager persistence had won her over. He was a charismatic man, and she loved him. Her counselor brain wasn't much of a match for those two facts. Quieting her noisy memories, she focused on Pete's partner resume. The top criteria were all represented. Funny, check. Smart, check. Kind, integrity, sexy, check, check, check. The second tier was also well represented. Fit, employed, kid-friendly. And finally, the tier that should not be named, the tier that was important but shallow and only whispered about with best friends. Nice lips, toenails clipped, an adequate penis size. Not huge, not minuscule, just adequate. On paper, Pete looked perfect, and he felt pretty perfect, too. She had committed to at least 6 months in Hawaii, thinking, finally, an uncomplicated, nice, normal guy. Finally, someone who seemed to fit her. And so what if he was more impulsive than she? So what if he exercised like he was running from a swarm of locusts? So what if there were times when she relished the quiet of his long runs and multi-day bike rides? So what? The real truth was that she needed a break. She'd agreed to accompany him to Hawaii in a wild moment of anger at her sister, Wendy, an inability to continue to come up with excuses for Pete, and pure exhaustion brought on by being her mother's sole caretaker. The last one simply broke Tig's heart. Every time she entered her front door, now that her mother was gone, she felt loss, guilt, and grief. It didn't matter that her mother had become unsafe in Tig's home or that her urinary tract infections seemed to sprout out of nowhere. Tig missed her. The best thing for her would be to get out of this house for a while. Now, however, all of her reasoning, plans, and ideals had been shoved aside like a dusty curtain, and she had no idea what to do. She turned to Macy and said, "When you say, I love you, do you mean it like a promise? Or do you mean it like, I feel this right now, but things might change tomorrow?" Macy blinked.
"Who, me?"
Tig shook her head. "Never mind. Sit with me. We'll make a new plan."
"We? You want me to help you plan?"
Macy smiled and sat at the kitchen table. Tig yanked a yellow legal pad from under a stack of unopened mail, and a wrinkled page of doodles flopped into view. Tig scrawled options at the top of a fresh sheet of paper. "What are my options?" Tig wrote number one, circled it, then wrote, "Get job back." Macy smoothed the crinkled paper and examined one of Tig's doodles. Sketched in blue ink were a palm tree, a cruise ship, and a hula dancer.
"You're a good drawer, Dr. M."
Tig grabbed the page from Macy's hands, strode to the sink, shoved it down the garbage disposal, and flipped the switch. The disposal made the sickening sound of something shoved beyond its limits. "What else can I put on the list? Help me brainstorm." Macy widened her eyes and said,
"Not to be, you know, negative, but you can't get your job back."
Tig said, "Come on, what else?"
"You could go to Hawaii. It's not just his Hawaii, you know. You don't have to stay here."
Tig scowled. "Don't be ridiculous. That idea has pathetic written all over it. Pathetic and stalker."
When my cousin got dumped, she took a pole dancing class. It's all about empowerment, building strength.
Tig frowned. I don't want a fad. I want a future.
Besides, stripper classes are the scrapbooking of the new millennium. It's just a band-aid. Only with better abs. Dr. M, you've got a lot of mascara on your face.
Stay focused. We only have one thing on the list.
Tig looked at the ceiling, then wrote, Number 2, get a different job.
What other job could I do?
As Macy wet a paper towel, took Tig by the chin, and wiped at her cheeks, Tig said,
I hear Starbucks has great bennies.
She pushed Macy's hands away and wrote, A, Starbucks, B, Pottery Barn, and C, Ann Taylor under the number 2.
I'm not a therapist like you, Dr. M, but I think maybe you should take a break from work.
That would kill me. All I would do is think about Pete and my mother.
Well, that might be okay. Don't you tell people to reflect a little to get better?
I don't need to get better. Better than what? I'm good. Pete's the one who needs to get better. What kind of person does this?
Tig gestured around the room as if displaying the obvious, as if the broken pieces of their relationship could be seen scattered around the room.
So what exactly happened? I thought you didn't want to go with him, but now you do?
I wanted to tell him that I needed more time, but then he told me I needed more time, and that he...
Tig paused, because really, this was the hardest thing to stomach, and the thing that was clearly the root of her emotions.
He wasn't that excited about me.
Oh,
Macy said, like the O had been caught in her throat and she'd been slapped on the back. Tig wrote on her list, Number 3, quilt.
Do you quilt?
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.